This man's name is Captain Marvel. This man's name is also Captain Marvel. They have nothing to do with one another. This Captain Marvel appears in books published by DC Comics. This Captain Marvel is published by, Marvel Comics. This Captain Marvel is one of the oldest and best-known comic book characters in the history of the medium, and at one point he was even more popular than Superman. This Captain Marvel has never been well-known or popular. Ever. This Captain Marvel, despite his fame, isn't allowed to advertise using his own name. He can say it, but every book, toy, movie, and TV show about him has to use the printed moniker of Shazam, referring to a magic word he speaks to gain his powers. This Captain Marvel is actually an alien named Mar-Vell, but he gets to put Captain Marvel all over his merchandise, which almost no one will ever buy. What the hell is going on here?
Comics are weird.
That's what. And one of the reasons why is that decades of storytelling can unfold as an expression of publishing industry politics, like, say, trademark disputes. Okay, here goes. After the success of Superman, damn near every magazine publisher out there tried to cash in by creating their own version. Fawcett Publications' contribution was Captain Marvel, and they set him apart from the pack with the mother of all secret identity hooks. Captain Marvel was actually a little boy. In the story, a homeless newsboy named Billy Batson meets up with a wizard named Shazam, actually an acronym for the six legendary heroes whose powers the wizard has cultivated: the wisdom of Solomon, the strength of Hercules, the stamina of Atlas, the power of Zeus, the courage of Achilles, and the speed of Mercury. By speaking the word Shazam, Billy is able to gain said powers and transform into an adult-sized superhero. And there you have it. Everything that ever needed to be said about the innate appeal of the superhero empowerment fantasy summed up in a single character. Kids loved him, and for most of the World War II era golden age of comics, Captain Marvel was the most popular hero out there, and National Comics, who felt they'd invented the genre with Superman, didn't like that one bit. They began suing competitors, especially Fawcett, for ripping them off almost immediately, going back and forth in a series of court cases ranging from 1941 until 1953 that ended with a financially strapped Fawcett settling out of court and agreeing never to publish Captain Marvel characters again. Since superhero comics were all but extinct by the 1950s, it wasn't seen as a major loss. But in the mid-60s, the Silver Age exploded and superheroes came roaring back to life. DC Comics, National's successor, bought the rights to Captain Marvel from what was left of Fawcett and planned to revive the characters and add them to his expanding roster of costumed superheroes. But they hit a snag. See, the early part of the Silver Age was dominated by a publisher previously called Timely but now called Marvel Comics. Always on the hunt for new material, Marvel's bosses had noticed that since it hadn't been published in over a decade, no one owned a trademark on the name Captain Marvel, so they proceeded to snatch it up by making up one of their own. In this new story, the Kree, one of the many, many, many races of aliens actively at war with Earth and the Marvel Universe at any given time, send a military captain named Mar-Vell to spy on humanity. When humans overhear his name and rank and get a look at the absurdly ostentatious Kree military dress code, they mistake him for a costumed superhero and assume his name is Captain Marvel. When he learns his superiors aren't on the up and up, he switches sides and takes up the identity for real. While the series accomplished Marvel's goal of securing the Captain Marvel trademark, thus forcing DC to market all publications and merchandise relating to the original Captain Marvel under the Shazam branding to this very day, readers really didn't give a crap about Mar-Vell, even when he got a better costume and a new status quo that involved interdimensional body switching with former Hulk sidekick turned Captain America sidekick turned perennial Marvel Universe also-ran Rick Jones. Let's not even get started on him. Still, in order to keep that trademark, Marvel had to keep publishing a comic with that name in some form, which has allowed the Mar-Vell legacy to get incredibly convoluted. Writer Jim Starlin, in particular, used him as a jumping-off point for an entire universe worth of cosmic characters, and was even permitted to kill him off in a well-remembered 1980s graphic novel. But the name, of course, had to live on, so there have been at least four Captain Marvels and one imposter since then: Monica Rambeau, Mar-Vell's son Genus Vell, and later his daughter Phyla Vell, and Novar, formerly known as Marvel Boy. I'm actually unsure who's using the name right now, but you can be sure it won't stay dormant for too long. Ironically, these days the Mar-Vell franchise has been overshadowed by its one-time distaff counterpart, Ms. Marvel, who could probably be a whole episode of this all by herself. Yeesh. Of course, the original Captain Marvel was no slouch in the sidekicks and successors department either. Along with teen sidekick Captain Marvel Jr., twin sister Mary Marvel, and non-powered con man Uncle Marvel, he also had the lieutenants named, no fooling, Fat Marvel, Tall Marvel, and Hillbilly Marvel, who had their powers because, again, no fooling, their names also happened to be Billy Batson. Oh, and I'd be remiss to ignore Hoppy the Marvel Bunny. So, now you know that stuff. Welcome to my head. I'm Bob, and that's the big picture.